So this next session is about a tabletop exercise, and to walk us through what this tabletop exercise means, what is a simulation, I'll call in Mr. Divakar Shetty. A quick introduction to Divakar while he comes online. Divakar is an industry veteran across more than three decades of experience. Hello, Divakar. Specifically across JP Morgan for more than a couple of decades, across Japan, Singapore, India, managing end-to-end infrastructure, correct? So he's really a veteran on infrastructure, on cybersecurity, on risk, working with regulators, managing the risk framework, and driving as people as well. So not only technology, but driving people, businesses, and managing the overall environment. So with that, I'll welcome Divakar and hand it over to him. Divakar, welcome.
Hi. Thank you. Thank you, Samir, for the nice introduction.
Give me a second. I'll switch on the presentation.
Yeah, sure. Good afternoon, everyone. Okay, I will quickly run through on this short introduction on what we are going to do today. And then I will hand it over to Suresh later on to run the entire exercise. And there will be a few key players who are going to enact some scenarios. And I'll introduce them later on in the on the deck. So to begin with a short agenda, I'll give you a short overview on what this means. What a tabletop exercise means. I'm not sure if all the industries are running it, but coming from a banking background, I know that this is the core of everything that is required in a banking environment when it comes to a crisis, whether it is a financial crisis or whether it is a technology crisis, whether it's a risk agenda or whether it's a cyber attack. And that is where things can go wrong if we don't have things in place properly organized. And that is where I remember when working for JP Morgan for many, many years, we used to have this exercise at least twice a year, wherein right from the CEO of the organization to the CIO to the last guy on the ground who used to give those services to the end user used to get involved. And that is, we had a perfect framework where we used to get the things done. And particularly focusing on this exercise, I will go around with the healthcare sector, the challenges which are overriding this sector currently, given the scenario, given the pandemic, it is all the more scarier. Then I will start up right away. Incident response tabletop, what is it exactly? So when we say what? An incident response tabletop exercise is the process of simulating an event to develop a very high-level understanding of current cyber security processes. In the sense that how is the information flowing, how are the alerts generated, how is the communication flows. We need to take care that communications don't break down and create chaos unnecessarily. And as I said earlier, why are these exercises a critical success factor in the way we run our businesses is, you know, in the maintenance of a comprehensive, integrated and security-focused plan so that we can keep this plan handy whenever there is a crisis of this kind. And how do we achieve it? There are goals. Testing the incident response plans and process via simulated real-world events and facilitated discussions. So, moving on to the next page. What we heard from General Pant, because I only joined the later part of the, and he came about over the entire talking about the masses in India also, how we want to protect them. But at the need of the hour, particularly in this session, what we would like to focus on is the healthcare sector. What we have seen in 2019 is more than 2 to 3 times more attacks have been done in the healthcare industry, the latest being Dr. Reddy's lab a few days ago. Around 41 million patient records were breached in 2019. When we talk about Singapore, I think Singapore comes across as one country in the world which has probably the best organized technology sector, cybersecurity sector. But can you imagine that a few years ago, the Singapore hospital data was completely hijacked by cybersecurity criminals and to the extent of the Singapore Prime Minister's data being taken away. So this was a shocker for Singapore too. And we consider that Singapore is one of the top brass countries in the world, along with Israel, which, you know, that they are way ahead of times in protecting their environment. So 70% of this malware outbreaks which are happening in healthcare were mostly ransomware. As you know, when General Pant also mentioned, when you talk about ransomware, is everything comes to a standstill until you pay them the ransom. And nowadays, the latest fashion is they want to be paid in bitcoins. They don't want cash. And ransomware attacks have been quadrupled between 2017 to 2020. And it is expected to grow by 5 times more in 2021. So, and given the current pandemic conditions, you can imagine how important your healthcare data is. 50 times more valuable on the black market than your credit card data. So this is something really phenomenal, which we are talking about. And all the more, we need to be more careful in the way we want to, you know, protect our environment by spreading awareness and putting in the right focus and putting the right capability to run our organizations. A short scenario summary. Axis Healthcare is the company which is going to be enacted, a leading healthcare organization in India specializing in critical care. Organizational mission theirs is a pan-Asia presence in the next 2 years. Axis has experienced a prolonged outage in its HMIS, Healthcare Management Information System, last year. And the Axis CIO led the remediation effort. Continued pressure to expand the operations and drive profitability is the scenario, but at the same time with the Damocles sword hanging on their neck to ensure that they achieve what they have planned for. And this is just a disclaimer that this is a simulation of a probable incident and it is not linked to any real life organization or incident. Simulation exercises such as this need to be run by the cybersecurity experts only. The actors involved are only role playing the incident and not of the resolution steps covered herein. Now, coming to the participants in this whole scenario exercise, I think many of you have heard from Suresh. Suresh Bulusu, he is an industry veteran for the last 37 years in the IT industry, having started as a technologist, and he has performed various technology leadership roles in organizations such as ABB, Wipro, HP, and JP Morgan. A business transformation leader, he has led change, managed diverse teams, and has consistently delivered global business goals. Suresh quit as an executive director from JP Morgan, so I know him for almost more than 15 years in the bank itself. And his role at JP Morgan, and then he started his company called Smart Transformation, an IBM partner. And his interests mainly lie in consulting in the areas of cybersecurity, IoT, analytics and smart city advisory. So that's Suresh in short for you. Munjal Shroff, another industry veteran, amazing guy. I'm pretty impressed with this person. A veteran of media and tech entrepreneurship landscape, Munjal's contributions have had an immense impact across the US election reforms, India skills policy, healthcare standards, and he is the co-chair of FICCI Animation VFX National Chapter. So that's Munjal in short for you. I can go on and on, just like Suresh regarding Munjal. And then we have Dr. Kavishwar Vagolikar. Kavi is an assistant professor in medicine at the Harvard Medical School and an assistant in computer science at Massachusetts General Hospital. Dr. Vagolikar's research is on the development of a new generation of healthcare infrastructure that incorporates artificial intelligence and emerging health standards. So we have a doctor in our group also who probably will fit into the CEO role. So these are the roles which are being paid. Dr. Kavishwar Vagolikar will enact the CEO role of Axis Healthcare. Munjal will be the CIO, Axis Healthcare. And the facilitator will be Suresh Bulusu. So Suresh, can I hand it over to you now? Can you run the exercise for all of them?
Thank you, Diwakar, and thanks for bringing back the memories of the bank 15 years. Yes, we can bank on you. Okay.
Thank you.
So, one request before we start the exercise. I had requested Mr. Rajan to be one of the observers, and I had requested Divakar himself to be one of the observers for this exercise so that we can do a SWOT tomorrow when we do the debrief. And I also requested Ms. Namrata to also be an observer. I don't know if she's still there. So we can get an idea from the press also. So this is a session which is going to be interesting from the kind of plans that we have made. As Divakar mentioned to you, this is something which is part of our daily activities when we are working in technology in the banks. And this is something which is taken very seriously so that we are ahead of the curve in terms of looking at what can be a legal issue, what can be a financial issue, what can damage the bank's visibility and those kind of things. So that said, I welcome Kavi and Munjal, my two good friends, to be the participants in this exercise. So let's roll. Sameer, you'll have to change the slide. So can you move to the next one, please? Okay, the scenario is starting, and the CEO's when he opens his desk at 10 a.m. and he comes to the office, he finds this big black thing on the screen which says that your personal files are now encrypted, and it gives him an option either to view these files which are encrypted or go to the next one. Now his machine is locked. He doesn't know what to do. So since he's a CEO, he has access to all the CXO, so he calls our good friend Munjal, the CIO. So the first question here is to Munjal, what do you see from this?
Right. So I've just walked over to Kavi's cabin, and I can see that there's a screen which says that the personal files are encrypted. I will have to look into right now what exactly has happened and what this has triggered. Most likely it's a malware, or possibly Kavi visited some site which basically had a malware in it.
So what is the conversation that you're having with Kavi at this point in time? What do you hear from him?
So I'm at this point, I'd ask Kavi, any idea what did you exactly do and how this triggered this?
I think I was looking at looking at security things last year, browsing the net, and something might have been related to the websites, one of those. I think there was a certificate error or something which I got when I just clicked on the pop-up. I didn't think of what it is, and it could have been because of that.
Right, but was it a mail or something that you saw, or was it from a website? Do you remember exactly what happened?
Yeah, now that you say, it was an email which told me about some more information related to what happened last year, and I think I clicked on that. That could have triggered this.
Okay. Any idea?
So, based on that, Munjal, what are your thoughts? He's clicked on an email. And
yeah, I'm just curious as to who sent him this email, So, was it from one of his known people from his group, or was it come from outside? So, I think right now, probably what I feel is that maybe this is just an isolated case. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to swap his laptops. Kavi, I'll give you a new laptop, and I have your data backed up there. And I think you should be up and running immediately.
Wait. Do you think that is enough at this point in time to just hand over a laptop and move on? What do you think?
Yeah, it's enough. I have a pretty packed day today. I have some server patches which have to be installed. We are also installing the robotic surgery CyberKnife equipment, which is, that team is waiting for me. So, while I asked my deputy to look into Kavi's laptop and see exactly what has happened, probably at this point, I think this is just an isolated scenario based on what Kavi is telling me. Of course, we will drill into this, but I think let's not read too much into the situation right now, and let me give Kavi the laptop, and I'm just going to run back to my desk because I have a lot going on right now, on the floor.
Okay. So you are going to give Kavi a replacement laptop from your stores, and then you're going to move away. Next slide, please.
Yeah.
So now, as you are walking back to your desk, my question to you is, has this kind of brought out the confidence in you as managing the situation? In terms of whatever you heard from him, whatever you saw is happening, did you see any other signs? Did you see anything else that he did mention? What is going to be your action, even if it is going to be a single isolated instance? What is going to be your action?
Yeah, see, I will have to look into this, Suresh. Right now, frankly, he's the CEO. So, you know, my primary objective is to ensure that he is up and back again. And what I'm going to do is obviously look into this and see what exactly...
Do you think that is enough at this point, Munjal? You think that is enough to just look into the matter?
Yes, I think so. You know, we've now that you're asking me, we had a similar incident last year as well. You know,
oh, you had an incident like this. Okay.
Yeah. And I had actually kind of asked management to give me a bigger budget, you know, to institute some cybersecurity measures. But, you know, given how the pressures are on profitability, this has been pushed, you know. But I think I'm not too worried. I think it looks like we had handled this last year. So I know the simplest and quickest way is to just, you know, swap his laptop and move on, you know.
So let me ask you this question, Munjal. Now you are designated as the CIO. Are you qualified enough to be acting as a CISO, or do you have that role also bundled as a part of your role?
I would, you know, honestly, at this point, my organization, you know, only has me at its disposal. And I had actually requested for a dedicated CISO, you know, because that's a specialized expertise. And but being a healthcare organization, obviously, you know, we don't have a CISO at this point of time, but it is something that we definitely need to look into.
Okay, so at this point in time, from what you said, that you are quite happy to think of it as an isolated incident. Do you actually know what kind of access the CEO has got? Is he got access to the financial documents? Does he have, of course, he must be having a lot of confidential information. Does he have marketing plans and sales access? What kind of access does the CEO have on his account? Is it the account which has been hacked, or is it only an email which he has clicked on inadvertently?
Basically, see, he has a complete dashboard, so he has access to everything. You know, he has complete rights to all data, right from patient data to also, you know, as you know, Access is also running some research programs, right? In fact, we are working on a COVID vaccine trials right now as well. So there is a lot of sensitive data on his laptop and which he has access to.
Okay, but, so tell me this, Munjal, when you looked at it, you said it could be a malware, whereas the screen shows that it's a ransomware. So you still feel it's a malware, or you think someone is playing a joke or a game or trying to be funny?
See, given honestly, right now, the way the environment is, you know, I wouldn't rule out a Chinese hacker as well. But it's too premature, Suresh, for me to, you know, kind of really, you know, guess things right now till we actually drill down on this, and which we will, you know.
Okay, so how do you think this is going to play out? Is it going to spread through the environment in the facility in your hospital? What do you think at this point in time?
I hope not, because I think so far no one else has reported anything. So I would say that we are safe at this point. You know,
is his machine locked, or is his account locked? What do you think? You're going to change his machine?
Yeah, so at this point his machine is locked. So looks like he clicked on an email or a link, which probably led to this, you know, a typical... examples that we see in ransomware is that the data on the particular machine gets locked, you know. So we do regular backups. So we have his machine backed up. So that's not an issue. So we have a backup in the cloud, which we should be able to restore his data immediately, which is why I was able to quickly give him another machine. So I think
this is a malware and it's an isolated incident, are you thinking of notifying this to the leadership team?
I think no need, Suresh, at this point of time. Let's not unnecessarily create any panic in the organization, you know.
Okay, so if you're not notifying the leadership team, is there anybody else who's going to be notified? Is there going to be any communication around this?
Not at this point. I think my team is obviously looking into it. Till I don't have any more information, I don't want to, you know, do a knee-jerk reaction to this.
What do you think is actually the impact? You know, if his machine is locked and he's got access to files, do you think there could be a compromise in the passwords, or do you think some of his important files are encrypted and not accessible anymore?
If Kavi has been saving his passwords, you know, somewhere on his laptop, then yes, we are in trouble. But I believe he's sensible enough not to do that.
So since you were in, you know, great hurry because you had some other pressing engagement, did you have a chance to look at actually what was the impact on his desk? Were you able to press any keys or try to do some.
No, right now his machine, see, typically, you know, these malware attacks, the way they are, the ransomware attacks, the way they are, you know, they lock you out completely. So even if you reboot your machine, as you know, it will again come back with the same message, right? So at this point, it's completely locked out his machine. So what we will simply do is we will format this machine and restore his data and then swap the backup laptop back again. So
Kavi asking you now, are you satisfied with what is actually happening? Or your expert has told you that at this point in time, it's an isolated case and he's probably providing a standby machine for you or a replacement. Are you happy with this situation?
I am right now because I have complete faith in my expert. And I've got these things from last year, and I'm thinking, you know, we don't have this communication with others in the team, so we need to reach out and find out. Maybe they're taking it lightly. So I'm concerned. I'm worried more about the operations in the hospital. I'm more worried about, there are patients who are getting care, whether our EHR systems are locked. I'm worried about, critical patients. I just don't want a scenario in which the hospital comes to a standstill. But I have faith in him, and I'm hoping for the best.
So my next question to you, Kavi, is like when a proposal was made last year after your HMI system was hacked into, proposal was made by your CIOs seeking more budgets and seeking a more robust plan. It was probably shot down. So what are your thoughts?
Yeah, I think we need to revisit that. These are all new things which are emerging. And we haven't thought seriously. For us, it's like IT, you know, everything comes under IT. And I think we need to better educate ourselves. So at this moment, I recall what the proposal was and all. And I should have taken it more seriously. We need to have a better plan in place. This situation makes me aware of that.
Okay. So if you're going to look at that proposal, what is the first step you would take?
I think the first proposal is to get the board, you know, the hospital board, understand it, how critical this whole thing is. Because we're taking the IT systems for granted. They work as the key, the whole operation.
Hey, Samir here, one of the critical care department has just notified me that the CT scan has stopped working. Is there any issue going on in IT? Because Munjal is not taking my call. Is there some problem or the CT scan machine has stopped working? So maybe I should talk to the vendor or?
Kavi, what is the message for Samir? He's asking you a question as to should Munjal is not taking his calls and
discussions now. I'm trying to read Munjal. I just connected with him in the morning. CT system, you say, how can the CT scan system? So Samir, I had an issue with my laptop getting locked out in the morning, and I've been in touch with Munjal about it, and Munjal thought it is isolated, and I think it could be very much related to it. So we should reach out to him and see. So what's happening right now is this, what are we doing with those patients? Is everybody safe?
I don't know. I'll go check. I don't know.
Okay, let's do that. Let's look at, we'll continue to contact Punjal and see what we can do. But first, let's look at, that everything is fine, that the patients are safe, and let's not, if there are any procedures which we can avoid, which can be scheduled, later on.
So, Kavi, you've got multiple things now. You've got your own machine which is logged in, and then you have your friend coming in and saying that his CT machine has gone. Now, I understand there's an inject too. There's a penetration of this virus now. It is going through. Where is Munjal? Can you reach him? Can you ask him to come over?
Suresh, I've just got the message as well because someone reached out to the IT help desk as well. So I think we are in trouble because the CT machine is closed, the MRI machine is closed, and I right now my honestly, my worst fears seem to be coming true because we have surgeries lined up, you know, and we have two people going in for a bypass as well. So I need.
So it's a very similar screen, Munjal. What was seen on Kavi's?
Yes. I think the worm has spread. It has spread to pretty much at this point, almost 70% of the machines are locked out. And my major concern.
But some things are working. You know, even in this space, I can see that your IT processes, the help desk is kicking in. People are logging calls into help desk. So the IT processes seemingly are working. Yeah. So. I wanted to check with you, like, do you know how many machines are affected or locked, very similar to Kavi's machine?
Yeah, I just, you know, my deputy just told me that apparently Kavi had clicked on a mail that came from the marketing team for some celebration and basically some vouchers were being given out. And so pretty much anyone who has clicked on that voucher link has essentially been hit by this particular ransomware attack.
Okay, so you have zeroed in on the mail which has been, which is related to a. Okay.
Yeah, and the funny.
So, Kavi, is it correct? Is that the mail that you clicked on?
I think that seems right. There are so many emails you are clicking. I think what you are mentioning is correct, Munjal. It could be that anniversary mail. Yeah.
Yeah, but you know, Kavi, it's something. I mean, this is basic cyber hygiene, right? I mean, that mail is not even from our domain, and one can clearly see from the sender's email ID that it's not. You know. So again, I think this is something, you know, I wish we had undertaken the program on cybersecurity awareness, which I had recommended last year, you know, because not just you, you know, so many people in the organization have blindly clicked on that email and which has caused this problem.
Yeah, Munjal, it looks very obvious to you, but for us, like, there is just one letter difference in the domain, you know, in the email, and it's very difficult to notice unless you have an eye of a program, of a expert. You know, the mail looks, and it's like from our team, and look at the name the mail has come from, the marketing team. It is just one letter which is different, and I couldn't pick that up. And I think most people have not picked up because of that one letter difference.
Okay, so I understand you guys are talking about cyber hygiene at this point in time, and we also have to go back to how did the firewall let this in, and what was the controls which were supposed to be. But more importantly, problem on hand, what is the impact on the patients? You said surgeries are lined up, the nurses are not able to give their medication, systems are hung. So what happens to the patients now and the patient care people who are there, the relatives and friends?
Yeah. So right now this is like, you know, we have got our basic process in place in which, like an emergency, so all the units have, many of the units, we have this drill in which when critical systems go down, when there is no electricity and things. So we treat it like that. So we're going to stop.
Kavi, if you can say on what is actually happening on the patient-related issues, technology issues, I will take it up with Munjal because he will probably understand which network was connected at that point in time where password shared. But coming to the patient care, because you did mention that patient care is most important, and is there going to be any effect on that or impact on that?
So what I've initiated is I've told my units to stop all things, you know, to schedule, cancel all appointments which are not critical. That's a lot of business loss to us. But for things which are critical, like patients who need, you know, who are in the middle of a procedure, or, you know, some patients who need emergency care, the emergency systems are on. But we are switched to using, paper. Okay. And we are continuing our care, and that's what we normally do. In these kind of situations.
So, how do you read into this, Munjal? How long will they have to use paper-based systems before you can say that yes, everything is good now?
Yeah. So here's what I'm doing, Suresh. Now, you know, I am disconnecting the internet. I am also shutting down my intranet so that the worm doesn't spread. You know, it doesn't spread too much. What I'm next going to do is I have asked the head nurse to do an assessment of how many beds we have empty at this point, because we have about 20-25 COVID patients waiting for to be admitted. So I want to ensure operations, you know, coming back. So we're going to move to pen and paper model at this point.
I heard you talking about disconnecting the internet, which is good, which is one of the steps recommended in the cybersecurity model. But what about people who are having remote access?
So those we've sent out messages to them as well that at this point to cease all operations and not to access their mails because we'll have to clean up our mail server, because obviously this mail is sitting on our mail server as well. So anybody who is accessing the mail on webmail on their laptops also will be hit. So we've
my next question would be in terms of how are you going to look at monitoring the system logs and monitoring your firewalls, ensuring that, you know, the systems which are not locked in at that point in time are safe now.
Right. So which is why what I'm recommending is to shut off all network, you know, internet and intranet. And what I'm now doing is I've asked my team to ensure that the CT scan and MRI machines come up, you know, as standalone machines. So at least the scans can resume, you know, because there are some, I said, the surgeries are slated. So hopefully we should be able to, you know, start some of these critical functions back. Will stay impacted is obviously billing will not happen immediately and new patient admission will not happen immediately.
So you have to worry about connectivity, you have to worry about integrity, you have to worry about availability.
Yeah, you know, services. I mean, for us, the patient health and security is paramount at this point, you know. So I need to make sure that the hospital is functioning just because the systems are down, you know, because right now we've just had a shift change. Let me ask both of you one
very sensitive question. At this point in time, what are the notifications? You know, how did you determine where the attack started? You did mention that there was an innocuous mail which came in and there was a letter which was different from what it was. And we fall back on the lack of training and awareness which was there. But what is the notification that is going to go out? There must be panic set around patients, patient care people, your own employees. And what about third parties who are supporting you? Who's doing the communication at all with them? Kavi or Munjal or both of you or somebody else?
You know, I think Kavi should do it because I have too much on my plate. I need to get the systems back running. So I really need another time to deal with that. So I would request Kavi to take charge of that.
Yeah, right now what we just have is, the departments just cancelling out unscheduled things and we are not notifying anybody outside. We're trying to understand. We have notified the leadership, the board, that this is what's happening and we're investigating. But currently, as our focus is just to keep the emergency things running and avoid any harm to the patient. That is what we are focused on. And
so you're talking about minimum notification, which is internal. So jumping back to you, Munjal, is there an incident response team already activated? Have you thought of that?
Yeah, like I said, Suresh, we are looking into this right now. Now, what I'm doing is my deputy is taking over all the IT operations and I will have to now start functioning like a CIO, you know, CISO, sorry. So what I'm doing is basically start getting to the root of this problem and see how we can tie it down. I think we've isolated the mail, the rogue mail that came. And it also at this point, you know, suspicions are pointing towards two scenarios. One is a rogue employee who had, you know, apparently shared his credentials with someone outside. And I'm not even ruling out, that this rogue employee has colluded with some Chinese hacker, you know, and I think possibly that's why we are seeing this thing, because otherwise, how did he get access to the credentials and they were able to send the mail, you know, which is looking like one of our internal mails. So
if it is Chinese hacking, though, by now all the patient records and all your financials are available in Beijing and other places, right?
It could be the case. Yes. You
okay,
know.
So
that's why we have shut down the internet. That's why we shut down the internet to prevent any further damage.
Okay. So you have disconnected the internet. You also disconnected the. Have you disconnected the medical equipment from the systems?
Yeah, that's what we did, and they have now been brought up online as standalone machines.
Okay. So what is the path for moving towards understanding a little more details about, you know, is the mail which has been isolated going into the scrubbing servers, and then is it being addressed properly? Are you able to trace more details of the person who was, or the people, or whoever was involved in this? How much time is this analysis going to take?
See, it will take us, you know, it will take us at least 6-7 hours to really zero it down, you know, and like I said, that I'm personally taking over that aspect, but for me right now, getting the hospital back on its feet is paramount, you know.
So what about communicating to the press? How about communicating to the media? Have both of you thought of it, or either one of you thinking of it now? Kavi, Munjal?
That's Kavi's job. You know, I, like I said, that I don't have the time to deal with this right now.
Okay. Yeah, we don't have anything as of yet right now. That's an afterthought. Let's see if this is if this can be contained. If Munjal can do his job and contain it, it will be good. But that's a secondary consideration of
Let me ask you this question, Kavi. Let me ask you this question. What is the implication or impact on legal or regulation?
Yeah, on regulation, if we have to, Munjal has to investigate if, in fact, any patient data was compromised. Is it just that the system is halted? So if patient data is compromised, then there will be official notifications that we'll have to make. And that will be, there will be some penalty, you know. So that's something we have to really investigate, and, you know, we'll have some auditors and look at what's happening. So my hope right now is that there's no patient data which is compromised. Hopefully, it's just the systems which are locked. But that's a most important concern of the privacy and confidentiality of patient data. That is primary thing.
You did mention that safety of the patient was most important, and therefore now you're getting into the confidentiality of the patient's data. And I also understand that Munjal has taken the CISO role now. He has moved away from the CIO role and CISO role. So Munjal, asking you this question, since you're not focused on IT anymore and you're looking at the entire CISO 9 yards of the responsibilities over there, what other signs do you see of this attack?
See, Suresh, I see it's a very organized attack and a well thought out attack, you know, right from understanding how our hospital functions to you know, targeting the employees, you know, at this point. And I really wish that Kavi would have listened to me and would have given us the money to install the right hardware, the firewalls and all of that, you know, and we would not have faced with them. I mean, we've not learned our lessons, you know. We had a similar incident last year as well, and we managed to contain it. And somehow, you know, we continue to operate in oblivion, you know, and hoping that nothing will go wrong with us. I think.
Kavi, this question is to you.
During the COVID times, the I'm seeing that the attack has gone up almost threefold, you know.
Okay. So, Kavi, this question is to you, saying that do you have plans to expand in Asia Pacific? But I see that, you know, there's a lot of gaps in your risk posture or your roadmap on risk and security. So, this is going to cause a lot of problems, specifically if you're going to move to a more organized country like Singapore, and they will ask you for all these alignment to your regulations, legal impact, your customer impact. What's your answer for that, Kavi?
Yes, we don't have a good answer right now, and this incident has woken us up. I just hope that, you know, this is contained, and but I can easily see, unless I'm in this incident, it's very difficult to fathom how far-reaching consequences it has got. It affects everything. The negative press and all, you know, that's a very bad consequence.
Negative press has not happened so far. But
yeah.
I heard you speak about containment. So, Munjal, if you're talking about containment, the first thing is triage and analysis. So, where are you on that, my friend?
Well, I don't have enough tools, Suresh, to really assess. So, it's going to be manual, debugging tools at this point of time, and which, as you understand, will take me a lot more time. But really, you know, like I said, that the challenge what we can do at this point is delete the mail, you know, that came, and now the team will individually scrub the machines to ensure that we don't have this problem. Fortunately, we have offsite data backup as well, so we will be able to restore most of the data from that, you know, and we should be able to go back to.
So I was coming to that. That's a very important point. When you talk about backup data being retrieved, and you know, you're starting your systems afresh with that, that will be timed. In a hospital-like situation where you talk about administration of medicine or medication at a timely intervals, so what kind of data is going to come and how is it going to help, or is it going to actually create a problem for the caretakers, such as the doctors, the paramedical staff, and so on? And since Kavi is a doctor, he can take this question.
Yeah, it is a very frustrating point for the caregivers. They depend on us to really, on me, to see that the whole operation is, you know, the hospital is working fine and smooth. And, you know, with Munjal, and my duty is to see that it is smooth. But it is frustrating and very, people...
As we are talking, I get the story that, you know, the media has got to know of this. Now you are in deeper trouble.
Yeah, I think we'll put out a press note notifying that this has happened. And, you know, as we are looking at first, you know, seeing that there is no harm for the patients, and we'll report on this eventually. So we will do what, you know, what a trustworthy hospital is supposed to do.
Okay, and so we'll learn from this incident. V is going to be you and Munjal. Are you both the representatives for the PRO or the public representative for sharing communication, or do you have somebody else?
Yeah, I'll right now give Munjal the, you know, the free hand to write the note and explain what technical the issue are, and I'll obviously, you know, it'll go through me, but I would really rely on Munjal to do the assessment and see what how far reaching this is. I'm also concerned about I'm rather upset about our vendors. You know, it is just not Munjal, but the vendors should have also made the system secure. So Munjal, what's the role? How are the vendors supporting you? Is there any response from the vending from the vendor teams?
Well, they are helping us, you know, Kavi. But the fundamental problem is that we are not equipped to handle a crisis like this, you know. And our vendors also currently, we don't have any vendors who basically are specifically providing us, you know, in CISO services, right? So most of our vendors are conventional IT vendors. So they don't understand firewalls. They don't understand how to deal with a ransomware attack, you know. So the onus is again back on to me to somehow manage this and pull the rabbit out of my hat. And on top of it, now you're asking me to deal with media, you know, Kavi. It's just too much on my plate right now.
Okay, so let me ask you this question, gentlemen, both Kavi and Munjal. Has your hospital has access gone in for cyber insurance? Have you taken up a cyber insurance?
Does something like that exist, Munjal?
No, we don't. Again, so that gives this was part okay. of... This was part
okay,
of
so
the
what,
plan.
What about filing an FIR? Have you filed? See, it is important that we share our good practices and bad practices so that it becomes a knowledge repository, gets populated with that, and people can learn from that. Who's going to file the FIR? Who's going to inform the CERT and the IT cell?
Yes, certainly. We'll have to do that. We'll do that as soon as possible.
So you have to notify your customers, you have to notify your employees, you have to think about cybersecurity insurance, you have to talk about, you know, talking to your vendors and your third parties, you have to talk to your media. You guys have a hands full of work to do. So what is the area of containment now? Where are we on containment now, Munjal? While we are talking about these things, a lot of time has gone by. Where are we on the containment?
So we've managed to isolate the infected machines and we've taken them offline of the network. You know, at this point of time, you know, the acute care, financial system and diagnostic labs were impacted, but we managed to bring them back online, you know, as I said, that using offsite backup. So we would still have to figure out the data that is missing from the last backup. So that means that data would have to be entered back into the systems. You know, and eventually, I think, like I said, that at this point, we now need to really evaluate this and see where things stand, you know, because this has been one of my worst nightmares. I was always dreading, and today it's upon us.
So I heard you saying that it was a nightmare and you are the CIO, now you're double hatting a CISO. So what is your, personally, where do you stand in terms of, right in the middle of it, your CEO's already here. So what would you request from him as your immediate help right now to help with the containment and later to formulate a strategy?
No, my Suresh, you know, I'm going to be very blunt here. You know, I am obviously make sure that this crisis is over, and I will ensure that the hospital is back on its feet, and it's going to take us, you know, good 4 or 5 days of sleepless nights to ensure that everything is back to normal. But after that, you know, I'm going to give Kavi and the board 1 month notice, you know, and I am reiterating what my recommendations were. One is to upgrade our systems, you know, ensure network segregation, have a firewall upgradation, you know, hire certified ethical hackers to ensure that we are, you know, hacked to figure out whether we have any, you know, basically loopholes in our system. you know, and obviously we need to get cyber insurance. You know, we need to run cyber training awareness for our users as well. You know, and all this was given to the board, you know, last year, and I have submitted a budget as well, you know, outlining each of the aspects. I mean, fundamentally, you know, any cybersecurity approach has to be about detect, deter, and destroy. You know, so we have detected, but we have not been able to deter, you know, future threats. I mean, case in point being the attack today. You know,
I can see a lot of angst in what you're saying, and we have the CEO here. I definitely don't want to be in his shoes at this point in time, but yes,
yeah, and
a lot of questions to answer.
I'm just stating on record that I will now give the management 1 month's notice, and if these steps are not implemented, then they can have my resignation.
So Kavi, asking you this question, and you have heard from Munjal, you can probably respond to him. But do you consider, since you are a growing organization, do you consider yourself, your organization, to be progressive, proactive, reactive, or passive? What kind of an organization is yours? Forget the technology portion.
Yeah, we are a very progressive organization. So we don't want to be reactive, but progression means that, is this, how big is this a threat? And I think we have underestimated previously how important all these things are. So we would definitely have to have a plan in place and good setup and personnel and training and infrastructure to handle this scenario.
Okay, so my point to you here is, if you're talking about being progressive, which I'm happy to hear from you as a CEO, because the CEO and the board have to look at it from that angle. You have to be pragmatic, you have to be diligent, you have to be successful in whatever you're saying. So if it's something which you're going to present to the board, I'm leaving it to both of you gentlemen as to how you're going to be presenting it and making sure that what happened last year and what has repeated just now in the early period of this year is not going to happen once again. So with that said, I would like for any last point from Munjal, you or from Kavi. Any last points you want to share?
Kavi, why don't you go first?
Can't hear you, Munjal.
Yeah, no, I was saying that let's start with Kavi, let's hear his thoughts and then I will add to it.
Yeah, I think in general, like apart from the scenario about being in healthcare and my experience being in healthcare, I noticed that we don't pay enough attention to confidentiality, privacy and security. So actually, there is a very big overlap between security and confidentiality, right? So confidentiality of data, what I've seen, you know, in my career is that we need to make systems which are able to tackle a scenario even when a breach happens. For example, you know, if your data is, it's minimum use, right? You don't open up your system and, you know, for people who don't need access, for example, the address of a person, not everybody needs to know that, right? Only certain people need to know the address of a patient. So the systems are designed so that, you know, that data is not compromised. Even if others that's kept in a separate system that's encrypted, you know, there are some, so the, these design decisions taking into account the sensitivity of the data are critical, which I've seen a lack of that in whatever solutions people come up, even with the national, even with the, you know, the blueprints and the national, you know, I mean, the standards which, you know, which are people are promulgating, there has to be a more focus on sensitivity and protecting the data. And second point is about, we always talk about data is very valuable and analyzing it, you know, to drive insights is of big value to the whole healthcare ecosystem. I feel that taking security and sensitivity of data into the design of system is very critical to make that possible.
Okay, I hear you. Munjal?
Yeah, just to take the what point Kavi made forward, I find today that most healthcare organizations are completely ill-equipped. In fact, the biggest challenge that the healthcare industry in India today faces is the fact that we are oblivious to the data leaks that are already happening, you know. And at this point of time, you know, till you are not hit by a ransomware attack, you don't realize that you are actually vulnerable, you know. So whereas the hackers today are better off just trying to hack into your system, steal the patient health data, and it has a very good market globally, you know. I mean, a financial record today may fetch anywhere between $10 to $15, but a medical record can fetch as high as $40 to $60 per record, and it's also the least well protected, particularly if you talk in the Indian context, you know. So given that, you know, I think that there is some serious work that needs to be done here, and again, I think the first question is of awareness. You know, most healthcare leadership today are oblivious to cybersecurity challenge. You know, for them, cybersecurity is an antivirus. You know,
okay.
So it starts from.
I agree to what you're saying, Munjal. And what I think is basically today, when you talk about security is a part of our genes. You know, it has to be a part of our nervous system, whether it is in business or whether it is individual and so on. So when we have a standoff between what has been requested by the experts and where the budgeting and things like that, this is a typical case of staying in denial. So security is not like an IPL game, you know, where you have to play 20 overs and then game is over and things like that. This continues to haunt you and you have to be constantly on top of that. So just to quickly do a review of the exercise, thank you, gentlemen, both Munjal and Kavi. The tabletop exercise, when we talk about it, we had incident which occurred last year and there was nothing which was done about that. And since it was also not considered to be a learning lesson for us, therefore it went into this thing. So I would also look at how it is presented to the board and to the leadership team. Sometimes what happens is only when they perceive value will they come to the aid of somebody. When you talk about resiliency, today being in the healthcare, if somebody comes there and says that I'm not well, so Suresh goes to Dr. Kavi and says that, look, I'm not well. He does a battery of tests and then he recommends something as medication or treatment or something like that. So what we are talking about is that kind of resiliency when you're talking about this has to be looked at when you're running your business. And cybersecurity today is one of the most important things that we can talk about. Today, your crown jewels, which needs to be protected, your business, which needs to be protected, has to have the layer of security around that. More importantly, most of our organizations have a lot of vendor support, and these vendor support, we'll have to evaluate them, go through a checklist to see if they're following all the security regulations and rules that have been recommended, and pull them up if it is required, because I heard both of you say that our vendors are not the great guys. So why bring them on when they are not the great guys to be brought on? So the question is, do a self audit before you call in people. I'm also surprised. Last year, when you had this instance of your healthcare management system being hacked, there must have been an NCR in your audit report, non-confirmatory report. So what happened to that red or orange bulb which have been glowing there? So as a VCSO, we bring in the entire 9 yards of service that is required, right from eyes on glass, which you call as monitoring. We talk about vulnerability and risk assessment. We talk about penetration tests. We talk about recommendation on anything which is obsolete. Even the original manufacturers would not be supporting anymore. Simple things like, you know, Microsoft says that after some time, we won't support one version of MS Office. People still continue to beat it dead. You know, they don't realize that by doing that, the patches are not going to come in. By continuing to use that, you are going to expose yourself to risk and definitely your organization to risk and so on. Further, we are talking about a lackluster approach to the entire problem of security. And as one of the speakers mentioned, that far too many cooks would think that, you know, security is their job and they don't leave it to the experts. With that said, I pass it back to Diwakar. Thank you, Diwakar.
Thanks, Suresh. That was very good exercise, and for all the participants, I think they must have had a taste of what really goes on behind the scenes, whether it is a bank, whether it is healthcare or any other industry across the globe. What is important is communication, and communication. We see a clear lack of communication from the CEO and the CIO. Everybody is going on with their own roles, oblivious to the fact that something happened last year, but it was on the table, given to the board. But since things are running fine, okay, we are doing well, let's go ahead. Who cares? But then when a situation like this arises, and when your reputation is at stake, and it's just not a financial loss, it's the reputation, because financial gains and losses will always happen in a business, but the reputation is one thing which once dented, it takes a hell lot of a time to, you know, bring you back on the ground. And when you're talking about a upcoming business which wants to have that vision of growing into the region, and Suresh gave a classic example of just Singapore. It's just not only Singapore in the region. I mean, cyber awareness is probably catching up more in the other countries rather than in India. And again, coming back to General Pant's observation that we want to bring it down to the masses level. So when the CEO says, I don't know, you are a CIO. So that was very obvious. I mean, there is so much of lack of awareness in the healthcare system, particularly industry, which plays around with people's lives. So, you know, a lot of focus is required. And Suresh's final point on, if you cannot do it, and if your organization doesn't allow, and if you don't want to put in more people.
I think we lost him. Mr. Nair, you can take over now.
Suresh, if there are questions, I'm not sure.
Yeah, I think there are some questions. Bala, can you read out? I think it starts with Rajaram Muthukrishnan, I think. Just check, because I'm just going by the trail, if you can handle that. Yeah.
Yes, I'm already going through the trail of comments as well as questions.
You can read out some comments also. We have some time, no? So you can, if you think they are pertinent, you can read them out.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Good show, Suresh. Good show. That's the general Thank consensus you. From all of us. Good show. Super, yeah, super. We didn't know the CyberWiz team has such very accomplished actors.
Shashi, just about before Bala gets into the act.
Yeah.
I think this particular tabletop presentation to me is unprecedented on any webinar I've attended so far. Especially so that it talks about a very critical sector where all of us are involved in one way or the other. So next time I go to a hospital, I would like to check with the doctor how safe and secure I am. Because the one thing which I realize that how ransomware also affects this particular industry. I think I discussed with Suresh a case where a patient died because of a ransomware threat. This was in the Baltimore, I think in the USA a few days ago. So I think I sat through it, found very interesting as to what are the situation and what are the responses. And I think I make a great case that cybersecurity should be a standalone exercise in any organization. It should not be dependent on the CIO or the CTO or the CFO or much less the CEO. Because the CFO wants to save money. The CEO wants to show fat bottom lines profit. And the man who runs the facilities management wants it to be security to be part of his system. So you can't expect a full-blown security man to be, guided by, supervised by somebody who does not know the difference between onions and potatoes. I think to an extent, you gentlemen have done a fantastic job. I think that has been the icing on the cake. And I think I have a few more ideas. I think that when we have a get-together of our minds, then I will be able to share it. Meanwhile, congratulations to Suresh, to Munjal, to Samir, and to his two other colleagues. Thank you, gentlemen. A job very well done.
Munjal was very cool throughout. I mean, looking at him, hearing his responses, I was chilling. We were all chilling out here. So good.
No, Munjal has kept the Prime Minister under his thumb for his several of his yoga movies. How many was it, Munjal? 18?
Yeah, so 17 videos in 24 languages.
Keep the payment cross, I'm sure he's done a good job with us.
Thank you, sir. I'm sure if people find it useful, then I think our job is well done.
Yeah, one of the things that we could do, I can just add, both Mr. Heblika, Commander Watson, and also Suresh, this particular presentation we'll send out as a short video. It can be used also to showcase some of the threats that cybersecurity poses. I think it'll be a very good video when we have it and, you know, have it edited.
Yeah.
A good show. Yeah.
Thank you. To start with the comments, Commodore Vasan sir observes all these inputs can be built into a lessons drawn. And Rajaram Muthukrishnan sir observes that one of the first things that organization, that this organization is not aware of, clicking on email can cause so much impact. So he says, observes that the CIO office should have a greater control on what comes into network from the internet and have in place security monitoring elements. And from a business perspective, he also observes that the organization should have a non-tech based redundancy process where a business continuity plan with DR in place should be kept ready in place. And moving ahead, we have a question by Anurag Sharma. They have asked, if there are suspicion of Chinese black hat hackers behind the attack, have you informed the law enforcement or involved the CERTIN in the incident response operation onwards? I think it can be taken from anyone in the panel.
Bala, you can go through all of them and at the end of it, they can respond in the interest of time. Instead of addressing each one of them, they'll make a note of what is required and they'll respond at the end of it, all the panelists.
Thank you, sir. Most of us are based on comments based. This is the only question that I find in the comment section.
All right, you can read out the comments if required and pertinent, based on which they can make their responses.
Yeah. So let me quickly add this one line answer to Anurag Sharma. See, when he talks about, you know, have you informed, this is one of the questions which I had asked Munjal and the CEO, saying that, you know, legally and from the regulation point of view, and also from the filing the FIR, have we informed the authorities? We have to share good practices and bad practices, taking it from our previous speakers also. So definitely it has to be done, and that should find its way even in this tabletop exercise. So that's the reason I asked that question. I hope that answers you, Anurag.
Also, you know, Suresh, just to add, I think at this point of time, there is no regulation or framework currently that forces hospitals or institutions to report it. You know, which is also one of the reasons that while a lot of the health institutions potentially are being hacked, you know, but none of them are reporting it. It's only when you find that some of these issues are patient-facing issues and patients come out and report is when you hear about it. But you will probably not hear about the data breaches that are happening. Because frankly, the scary fact is that these hospitals themselves are not aware about the breaches today.
Yep. I think it was great to get Kavi in, because Kavi sort of shared what they do in Harvard and some of the US medical systems. Almost they run parallel systems there. So when such type of attacks happen, the secondary system takes over. So it was really interesting hearing from him.
Thank you, sir. A few observations that I would like to read out is that these kinds of things happen or take place due to lack of a risk plan in place. Most of these response. And all these kinds also happens because it is a lack of willingness to invest enough to have a redundancy and strong firewall that leads to such situation. When these are put in place, I think these kinds of threats and things can be averted. And there's one interesting question by Mr. Danish Sankin, who has asked, what about the leaked information of the patient? Will the patient be informed and given security by the company? This is one question that was raised. And going ahead with the comments, Commodore Vasan sir observes, a segregation of administration and operation for patients and in-house servers for patient care can be put in place so that it is not hacked, and this should be made as a prerequisite before giving clearance to healthcare institutions. It includes both private as well as public. And another observation is also making the system immune, depending upon the build standards, firewalls that were approved at the time of acquisition or installation. This is one interesting suggestion that was given. Moving ahead with Rajaram sir has suggested the security aspect of architecture deployed for such systems. He feels that it has not been addressed appropriately, so that an insurance policy itself would have initiated some of these as a part of the underwriting. Since this was not done, the impact assessment and the third party assessment were also not done. So can we take up that question? What about the leaked information of the patient? Will the company protect them?
Kavi, you want to take that?
Can you just rephrase the question again? I just lost connection for a second.
Yeah.
What about the leaked information?
Information of the patient. Will the patient be informed and given security by the company?
Yeah, that's normally like, you know, how it is, you know, at least in the US, that, you know, if the information of the patient is compromised, then let's say, for example, even in non-healthcare institutions, right? So there is an identity protection, which the, you know, institution is supposed to give. And there obviously has got to be notifications and yeah, so there is a lot of liability, you know, on patient information getting compromised.
But Kavi, we haven't seen something similar in India, have you? Have you seen something similar here?
I've seen data breaches, but I've not heard of. So we need, I think the legal framework is not yet in place. From what I understand, the privacy laws is very closely tied to privacy laws. And we yet don't have very strong privacy laws. Even if you look at now, what's happening with the media, I see, you know, WhatsApp messages and conversations getting shared, you know, you could even see healthcare, you know, histories getting shared. That definitely is ethically wrong. It's got to be legally wrong also. But I don't think we have the legal framework in place still.
Okay. Yeah, you're right, Kavi, there. At this point, you know, frankly, there is no accountability as well. Now, the proposed drafts that we are seeing around the Healthcare Information Act, you know, and the National Digital Health Mission, some of these things are being proposed. So, which is that if there is such a breach, then the hospital is held accountable, there is a fine, there is even an imprisonment. Okay. Now, some of these things are being taken up very, very seriously now. Question is, how much of this eventually finds its way in the final act is what remains. But I think one good thing is actually that people are talking about it with the government as well. So, there is a general awareness that after it, you know. So we should start seeing some move on this point.
I think Mr. Rajan wants to respond on that.
Thank you, Suresh sir. This is Rajaram here. On the last point on the legal impact, as an insurer, I can tell you that under the Indian law currently, although there is no data protection law in place, the leakage of information of the health or records of a patient is something which is a breach of law, and therefore the organization would be subjected to both criminal proceedings as well as tort producing proceedings for damages. And if the organization does not have a PI cover, a D&O cover, and a E&O cover, they would be subject to very severe financial penalties as well as under the penal code, the organization head can be prosecuted. That's what the law is at this stage. Just want to clarify. Thank you.
So, thank you, Rajaram. Is there, have you seen, I mean, is there a case in which this has been enforced or this has happened?
There have been many cases which has been brought to the courts, and awards have been, damages awards have been made in India as well. The indemnity insurance covers respond to this. They act in defense if the concerned hospital has the policy cover, they act in defense and contested claim. But if it is proven and the damages are being awarded by the courts and companies have been fined as well, it has happened in India. The only difference between us and the US is the quantum of the damages is somewhat limited and mandated as per what the law says. Whereas in the US, you have the punitive damages concept where a jury decides, a bunch of lay peer group decides on the extent of the punitive damages that can be you know, imposed, and that can be in millions of dollars. And hence in the US, that's a far, far bigger risk to not comply with such security standards as compared to the current Indian provisions. With the data protection laws coming in, we would look at strengthening this. And the insurance industry also is now in the mode of building up industry databases, which was not existent before, but now that is coming into play. The General Insurance Council, which regulates the health insurance aspect, also putting together an industry-wide data warehouse. The plan is on. I am the consultant for it, so I know about it. Thank you.
Great, sir.
Thank you. Nice.
Suresh, with your permission, if Pankaj Rajan sir, we can also ask his views, with your permission, sir.
Please go ahead.
Yeah,
So can you hear me again?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. So let me first congratulate Mr. Bilusu and his team for an excellent tabletop exercise.
Thank you, sir.
I was very happy to see this because in the military, we do routinely carry out not tabletop, we carry out war gaming. So it's good to see that those corporate practices have been taken on board. But my observations firstly are, you know, two, three of them. Because, see, let me explain. For example, when you build a building, let me give you a simile of building a building. So the strongest part has to be the foundation on which the whole thing rests, although it is not much seen. So when you carry that particular simile onto a nation, you might have the best policing, like you might have the best policing which is happening in Bangalore. But if the military cannot defend, you know, an attack from the Chinese or from Pakistan and we get taken over, that policing has no meaning for the citizen because you are finally again going under the yoke of a foreign, you know, colonization. I now bring that particular simile onto the cyberspace. Okay. This is all excellent. So what are the facts on ground? The facts on ground is all the iconic, you know, OEMs who are providing your ICT equipment, from the firewalls, your operating systems, to your Microsoft, you know, blah, 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 etc., part of the surveillance capitalism industry. Okay. So if your entire you know, architecture is cleared on surveillance capitalism, and these are all companies for profit, and this data, medical data, which has been highlighted, has got immense value. And if you notice, all these companies are trying to, you know, grab that data so that their bottom lines go up, and they're creating more and more, like your wearables, your smartphone ecosystem, all that is going for getting this information out. So, you know, when you start off a religion, you carry out a lot of rituals. You know, in a religion, there are so many things which are taken out. So this entire cybersecurity religion, basically, it has been ritualized by the West and taught to us. Okay, we have imbibed it. And what so presently happens in the US has no meaning here, because in the US, you take it from me, I doubt whether they permit Chinese firewalls in their critical information infrastructure. Okay, so they do not talk anything about it. It's taken as understood. But when we come out here, for us, the US, the Chinese doesn't make a difference, whether Germany, Britain, everything. If they are part of their information warfare architecture of the parent nation, and they're invariably taking your data out, what is the point of, you know, just going through, you know, assessment and trying to feel that, oh, we are safe. We are not safe. You have to first build your foundations. You have to create your own literature about all this stuff. You have to reassess how are we going to go about doing this. And therein lies a huge opportunity for India. Okay, if you now, I would request Mr. Munjal, he should take this video. He should make it this particular tabletop exercise, add certain other things also to this, and maybe start distributing it to all hospitals, etc. So people understand, oh, this is also a threat that can hit their bottom line. Plus also ask those fundamental questions. What is the point of building all this ICT infrastructure on global surveillance of some other country? And, you know, you're just being a fool. It's like, you know, I sometimes feel like I'm the guy who is telling the emperor, you're not wearing any clothes. So that is one. Now comes the IPR part of it. IPR. In this exercise, you also said that there was some, you know, research being carried out on stuff for the COVID investigation.
Right.
So obviously, what do we know today? COVID. If you are going to be if you are in a hospital where COVID investigations and research are being carried out, you are on the global surveillance hot list. You know. Okay, because everyone wants that particular this, what will sort out this COVID? So where is your plan for that? You've not even thought of it. And I don't blame the hospital authorities or the commercial vendor or the corporate to look into this. That is not their job. Unless General Pant and his team gets their act together, okay, and give that underpinning. And believe you me, he's again like the chief information officer. Unless the board of directors and the CEO decides, okay, we need to look into this, we are all in deep shit. So I hope...
Rajan, Mr. Rajan, the comment is that unfortunately the board of directors are busy with the election. So as was said, so
that is always the truth of the story. You know, when you start looking into why, as a great civilization, we got taken over so many times. You know, today the narrative is India was the greatest civilization of all time, and whatever has been discovered and is going to be further discovered is also we have done it before 30,000 years back. Okay, that is the narrative which we are trying
to build. It happened when we are not looking.
No, it is not so. It happens because what is happening today is that Sambhavami Yuge, you know, it's happening right as we speak. Okay, we are landing up for the, you know, gunfight with a knife. That's what is happening. Okay, so I would, you know, so what Munjal's role is to create videos, it needs to bring, capture all this, it needs to be taken to the masses, it needs to pressurize people. Otherwise, we don't have a hope. So that's my observation. Thank you.
No, in fact, Mr. Rajan, let me just respond. So one of the things that we are actually doing now with Fiki is we are publishing a white paper on the healthcare sector. And part of the reason why that entire exercise started was basically because we realized the shortcomings in the cybersecurity sector vis-a-vis healthcare is concerned, you know, number one. And I think, you know, as we were going through the session and looking at the feedback, I think, Samir, we should take this edited video and ensure that it is circulated within the FICCI healthcare sector as well. So I think it will bring tremendous value to them as well. So once it's hosted, you know, onto the YouTube page of PII, we can possibly share that link, you know, with other people as well. Because I think there'll be a lot of value that the sector can derive from that, you know. So point taken, Mr. Rajan. I think a lot of work needs to be done. We've just started today, and I think probably as we are coming in fresh, you know, we have new ideas and new thoughts. But this entire exercise has been illuminating even for us. As we started to work on this, you know, a lot of the facets started coming out, and we realized that, yes, there is a lot more work that needs to be done here.
Thank you, Pavitra, sir, for sharing your thoughts, for being insightful as well as invaluable, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah.
And to further go ahead with the comments, everyone were appreciative of this tabletop exercise. One final concluding observation by Commodore Vasan, sir. He observes, network certification and firewall for such organization should meet the minimum legal standards or requirements if required to be audited by an accreditation society. So with this, I think we have come to the end of the question and answer session. With this, I would like to hand over to Suresh, sir, to take over the proceedings.
Okay. So, thanks, Bala. Mr. Rajan, it was wonderful listening to your last point. In fact, I'll just add one point there. You know, between me, Samir, Munjal, and Divakar, we have faced this multiple times when we talk to not necessarily the healthcare, but others. They are already there in a sense of denial. You know, sab theek chal raha hai yaar, tum don't worry about that. So that becomes a bigger worry for us. Thank you for that. So let me bring this webinar to a close. And I think all the work that we did in the past few days, and it is a tremendous amount of work. Commodore Vasan, Mr. Nair, Mr. Heblikar, Bala definitely, even on Sundays and with the festival, I think we did a lot of work. Samir, myself, Munjal, Kavi, whom we brought in as a doctor. We thought definitely hearing from a doctor is much better than us pretending to be doctors. You know, that's what we do in cybersecurity anyway. And Divakar also had some challenges, but he came. So all is well that ends well. So I would say that we did pretty well in terms of the preparation, and I think the delivery was good. The participation was excellent, and I was reading some of the comments in the chat box as we talked about it. The first session where we started off with the India cybersecurity management, I think it was an excellent session. And kudos to Mr. Heblikar for chairing such a session, and wonderful speakers such as Mr. Rajan, Namrata, Anuji, and everybody else who actually participated in that, in terms of also giving comments and raising questions which you could answer. And I think it covered a lot of areas, which talks about how cybersecurity becomes a very, very important place for us to look at. And we had also heard comments of the fourth pillar after Army, Navy, and Air Force being the cybersecurity, and what it takes, what kind of wherewithal it takes for us to build better defense systems there. And we talked about the sleeper cells coming in from the Chinese hardware. We spoke about how China is actually you know, they set up a strategy and they actually work towards ensuring that the strategy is executed well on all different fronts. You know, one way, if you look at it, it is like a team project which you carry out in IT. You know, we set something up and we make sure that the project ends well. So when we speak about what was declared in the beginning, when Mr. Sanjeev Kale spoke about it, and he talked about BharatNet, and it was a good understanding of what actually happened there. Then we spoke about when Mr. Rajan came on, he spoke about different ways how China is basically looking at superseding what the US started as the area of network being, internet being something which was their monopoly, and taking it away from them and trying to make. And China is a land which is covered on three sides by land with only one sea open. So they have to find their way of doing their business here. So definitely it could be that could be one of their areas. And yes, they've always been stealing data from us. And, you know, I can cite my own example. I was there for doing an analytics training in Shanghai for 1 week. And every screen, somebody would get up and take a screenshot. I said, finally, I'll be leaving the presentation with you anyway. So why do you want to take photos now? So that's the way they are. And we need to understand they would probably do that in every act of life that they are doing. So wonderful session by Mr. Rajan, and definitely I will reach out to you along with my team, sir, at some point in time to share thoughts on that. And then Ms. Nimrata brought up the area specifically when the questions were asked in terms of how you know, publicity and how media can be an important player, especially when you're talking about sensitive and confidential data, and how we can look at various bodies which are actually being formed, but there's no cohesion, there's no coordinated approach as to our cybersecurity standard. And I think that was very important learning. And that is something which is crucial for success of any strategy. And we are speaking in the month of October, which is, as I said, a national day of cybersecurity across the globe. And the Prime Minister had stated a very clear message to everyone saying that Atmanirbhar is one, cybersecurity is definitely something which is going to be there. And Mr. Heblikar also shared at some point in time that, you know, what are closest to the Prime Minister at this point in time is that digitization is fine, but unless you have security coexisting with that, it's not going to be of much use and so on. And Dr. Anu Bhattan, the new facet in terms of people, we always take pride as technologists. We say that, you know, people, process, technology has to go together. But she actually mentioned that, you know, how you have to sensitize and how to have each person has their skin in the game when you talk about cybersecurity. Anything which is obsolete, anything which is a risk, can be an individual risk or it can be a collective risk, either at workplace or in a community. So these are very good examples of what needs to be done to sensitize people. And we need to also take a leaf out of our book in terms of what can be leveraged from the way they are sensitizing people in Singapore and how we can implement it. So I just put up a question to her there saying that please do share some of your thoughts on how we can implement there. And Mr. Rajesh Pant, in his easy, simple narrative, was able to give us a lot more information. And we feel a little more comfortable in terms of saying, yes, there's a journey, but we have already begin the journey. We can talk about us being a little late in that, but still we're on the journey, and I think we will probably see something happening faster. The question that is left with all of us is, where are we going to take this public private participation, my own knowledge of that, how are we going to share this knowledge, and where are we going to take this in terms of cybersecurity across our own lives, whether it is professional or personal, individual or company. So that's where we leave it, and we look forward to more such interactions. Thank you very much, gentlemen, and it was a great time being a part of this session. Thank you.